Alrighty, everyone that's already here, thanks again for attending this webinar. My name is Sam van Hees. I'm the co-founder and strategy director of Story of Amps. And today, this webinar is about how to convert and retain more customers. I will talk about how to convert more customers, and then Wouter van Horsen, head of e-commerce at ING, we'll talk about how to retain more customers and about the power of loyalty programs. So I will begin my part of this webinar with a quick intro about Story of Amps. For those who don't know who we are and what we do, I will keep this brief and short. Story of Amps is a digital agency based in Amsterdam. We are now with a team of 30 people. We work for many amazing clients, Lucas Bols, Signify, big companies, but also a lot of SMBs. And what we do is basically two things. We create e-commerce websites and apps. So the design, development, and strategy of e-commerce websites and apps. And on the other hand, we create creative concepts and then create the content, mostly video content. And then those two things together allows us to create e-commerce experiences your customers love. And what we always say to our clients, nice sentence, is that we increase conversion rates and market share. That's that about Story of Amps. Now let's get into the real stuff. We are in a new era. We are in the era of digital commerce because everything is happening online. And to clearly showcase this, I have a quote of the CEO of Adidas, Kasper Rorsted, and he said, "Our single most important store in the world is our .com store, and that there's no comparison." And I think this clearly indicates that, yes, indeed, we are in the era of digital commerce, and digital is everything, also for every brand. Trust and relationship. We all know this, but due to the corona pandemic, physical contact is no longer possible, or at least a lot less. And the relationship and trust you normally build with the appointment in an office or with your store and the employees that are in that store that can answer customers' questions, that remove doubts and build trust, is for most brands not really an option anymore. And that means that your online experience, your online presence, your digital presence is more important than ever. And why is that? Because you still need to forge relationship with your customers. You still need to build trust. You still need to answer all those questions. And now you have to do that with solely your digital experience, with your e-commerce experience. And how you can build trust, remove doubts, and build relationship with your e-commerce website or app is what I will talk about today. Forrester, a well-known research company in the US, last year they published a paper, The State of the Digital Commerce Experience. And in that paper, one of the main conclusions is that 80% of customers abandon their purchase, abandon your website because of a bad online experience. And in this case, a bad online experience means that you as a company, you are not providing those visitors, those customers with the right information, the information with which they can make a well-educated decision and make a purchase with confidence. And also if you look at Fortune 500 companies or SMBs, across the board, with e-commerce, most companies are not doing a really great job. And it's not so that the bigger companies are ahead or the smaller companies do it worse. No, across the board, it's not really that good. Because if you look at the average e-commerce website or app, it's all the same. They look alike. They have the same info on it, a homepage, maybe about page, product page with the same product photos and product descriptions that are almost the same as your competitors. In most cases, you also have to do your best to figure out what they do, what they stand for, how their products or services can help you, can help make your life better. And if we get a bit more practical and look at a simplified customer journey where the top of the funnel is, of course, the beginning of the funnel where you attract awareness and where you get visitors to your website. The mid-funnel is your e-commerce website or app. That's where you can convert visitors into customers. And then the end of the funnel is where people make a purchase. And as you can see in this simplified customer journey, it's actually the mid-funnel where most results can be gained, where most of the customers actually leave. And that's funny because if you look at the effort and time people spend, most businesses spend with regards to their marketing, most of those efforts are focused on the beginning of the funnel, getting more brand awareness, more people to the website, through social advertising, TV, radio, email campaigns, whatever. But if 80% of those customers abandon your website because of a bad online experience, because you don't have the right content on your website that helps them make an educated decision, that builds that trust, investing all the time and resources in, you know, the beginning of the funnel is not such a good investment. And then it's better to first look at, okay, what can we do in the mid-funnel? So basically our e-commerce experience to improve that. And that's what I will dive in right now. Because the solution for this problem lies in the mid-funnel, because the mid-funnel is where your e-commerce environment plays a huge role. And in the mid-funnel, your customer is full of questions about your brand, about your product or your service, and you want to be able to answer those questions to remove doubts and to build that trust. And to do this, you need to fill your e-commerce website or app with the right content, the content that answers your customer's questions, and like I said, removes that doubts. And how you can do that with content, that's where the 3S content model comes in place. The 3S content model is a model that's been set up for actually e-commerce experiences, and this is being used across a wide variety of B2C companies, but it's also suitable for B2B companies for digital experiences. And it's also for the larger and smaller companies. And what you do with the 3S content model is that you create the type of content that will guide your customers through that mid-funnel, that will answer all those questions customers have about your brand, about your product, about your service, and that helps them make an educated purchase or, purchase something with the confidence you need to actually, you know, purchase something. And now I'm going to dive into this model. The first one is shop content, first one of the three S's. And shop content is mainly about your brand, and it's also focused on video. And with shop content, you want to introduce visitors to your brand. You want to build a relationship with your customers. And there's no better way to do this with a great story, because story evokes emotion. Story does something with you, it makes you feel something, and no one's emotions or interest is sparked by a long product description. So the purpose of these shop content videos is to establish your brand, showcase what you do, why you exist, and how you can help make the life of your customers better with your product or service. And the shop video content, this main video, is there to spark people's interest, because if people are interested, they will spend a longer time on your website. And that means the longer time people spend on your website, the more chances you have to convert them, because they will scroll through more products, they will read more about your story and get more interested in everything that you have to offer. The second S of the 3S content model is service content. And the goal of service content is to answer the questions of your customers. These can be practical questions, such as how your product or your service works, but this also can be the emotional aspect. So how is your product or service making my life better? And there's a good example. I think we all know Coolblue. And Coolblue sells everything there is to sell, just like Amazon and Bol.com. But Coolblue also sells an interesting product, which are solar panels. And solar panels is not a product that you order, you receive it, and you hang it on your wall and it's done. No, it's a big project. Construction is involved. A lot of people are involved. A lot of moving parts are, you know, part of buying a solar panels for your house. So you have a lot of questions, and with questions also comes doubt. And to answer all those questions, Coolblue made some very nice videos wherein they explain the whole process from beginning to end. So from purchasing to delivery to the installation and everything that happens after that. And with that video, with that service content video, they answer all your questions. They remove all your doubts. And after you watch that video, you're actually, think, okay, buying a solar panel is not such a big deal. Maybe I can do it with them. And that's the goal of these videos. Because there's a saying from Donald Miller. He's the best-selling author of the book Story Brand, a book about storytelling and how you can position your brand. And he says, if you confuse, you lose. And what that means is that it's not always the best product or service that wins. It's the product that is communicated in the clearest and best way. And that's exactly what you want to accomplish with service video content. You want to answer all the questions people might have about your product or your service. Then, the last S of the three S's is sales content. And sales content is basically the last push that customers need to make a purchase. And it makes it clear one more time why they should choose you as a brand and then why they should buy that product or that service. And the best form of sales content is UGC, stands for user generated content, because in e-commerce there are a lot of advantages, but there's one overarching disadvantage, and that is that people can't get in contact with a product before they buy it. And that's why they heavily rely on other users, on reviews, on testimonials, on videos they see about your product and about your brand. And user-generated content makes super clear for other customers what exactly you have to offer, because they can relate way better potential customers to other customers than they can relate to a message from a brand to a customer. And another advantage is that you can sit together in a room with your marketing team or your agency and think of all cool ways to tell your story. But it's actually your customers that have the most authentic stories and the best stories to tell. And those are also the stories, like I said, that other potential customers can relate to the most. Those are the three S's. It's the shop about your brand, differentiating, positioning your brand in a great way. It's the service content, where you answer all your questions about your products or your services. And then it's the sales content, which provides that last push that people need to make that purchase, to feel that they're educated, to feel confidence in making a certain purchase with your brand. It's already end of my presentation almost, but I want to make sure that you go away from my presentation with new knowledge and also inspiration. And I know Patagonia is a bit of a cliche brand to mention, but please visit patagonia.com, because their website is filled with great content. All the three S's are implemented in almost a perfect way. Their content, on their website, you have documentaries, films about their products, about their brands, which spark your interest. Then they have a lot of service content about, for example, nice videos about the stitching technique they use, and that results in them being able to make the best mountain gear, and also a lot of sales content and then user-generated content, where they, for example, do an interview with a farmer in New Zealand, sheep farmer, and there, he's wearing their clothes, of course, and a nice interview, and he explains why these clothes allow him to do his best work. So if you are in the B2C world, then definitely check out Patagonia. If you are in the B2B world, then check out the big brother of Shopify, which is Shopify Plus. And they also integrate the 3S content model in a super nice way. If you go to their website, it's there super clear, to their social, everywhere it's implemented really nice. So yeah, that's the end of my presentation. It's not the end of this webinar, because now Wouter van Horsen, head of e-commerce and loyalty platform at ING. We'll talk about how to retain more customers and about the power of a loyalty program. So Wouter, I'm giving a virtual stage to you.
Hi, Tim. Thanks for having me. And hi, everybody at home. Also, thanks for having me. Let me share my screen first.
Yep.
Just a minute. Yes, I think it's right there. My talk about today is about ING Point, a platform to increase loyalty and engagement. Sam asked me to tell more about retaining customers and how we do this with ING, with our loyalty platform. So the first question, how to retain customers with the loyalty platform? My answer is actually threefold. One, be where the customer is. Second, be flexible. And thirdly, be relevant. Before I will dive into this further, I will introduce myself a little bit. Well, my name is Wouter van Horsen. I did my studies in marketing and logistics at VU University. And after that, I joined ING in several marketing roles. And in the past 4.5 years, I was responsible for the ING loyalty program. It was formerly known as Rentepunten, currently ING Punten, ING Points. And before that, I worked at several labels of the ING. I live in Diemen, close to Amsterdam. Normally, I go by bike to my my office at ING. But now, like most of you, working from home. Well, to kick it off, the first question is actually, why does ING have a loyalty program and how does it work? Just to give you a little bit of a context and what we did in the past years. First, the loyalty the loyalty program of ING. I will explain a little bit about the basics and how we became big. Actually, the program started in 2006 and it's based around loyalty points. Our customers receive currently loyalty points for lots of stuff. For example, opening a savings account, doing a bill sharing with their mobile app, using their mobile app for payments. Lots of stuff they will get points from, and the points have no expiration. So people can pile up their points, and with the points they can shop in the ING shop. And in the ING shop we have very high discounts. So actually, it's a price proposition where we offer a 50% discount on the retail advised retail price. And if this advised retail price is not that hard, we look at the lowest price online. And when we introduce a new product, it at least should be 25% discount compared with this lowest online price. And we try to make this price difference as clear as possible using references to kieskeurig.nl. And this discount, we actually get this discount from our suppliers, and we pass the discount on to our to the ING customer as a treat. So we offer them points to offer something extra, and the discount on the product is offered to the customers. And this loyalty program is cost neutral for ING, which actually means that we take a little bit of the margin for ourselves, but just to keep it at cost neutral levels and pass the discount on to our customers to get extra value for the loyalty program for our customers. And a last thing about the basics is that our loyalty points do not have a monetary equivalent. which means that a customer can buy with his points, but when they buy a product, they also have to buy with euros. It doesn't matter if you have like 100,000 of points, you cannot spend more points to get a higher discount. The discount is fixed. The amount of points is fixed per product. And we pass on this discount to our customers. Then one last remark about the products we sell. We have products like retail products. We have them stocked at our own warehouse and ship it to the customer after he bought it. Or vouchers, which can be redeemed at the merchant. Well, some key figures. We started in 2006 with 150 products in our webshop, and in that year we sold 173,000 products with a turnover of 10.5 million. Back then, this were great numbers for e-commerce platforms. But in the last year, over the years, we grew to a webshop with around 1,250 products in our shop. We try to have this as a maximum bit, assortment with a variety of stuff. So it can be tickets for the zoo or the cinema, but also laptop bags and electronics like TV sets and audio. Bluetooth audio speakers, those kind of things. Last year, we sold over 1.3 million products and with a turnover of 35 million. Currently, we have 4.5 million customers that have saved points. So these are actually the e-commerce metrics we use. But from a loyalty perspective, we say over 30 million value, which is discount for our customers, was passed on. And our net promoter score is also a key element, which was plus 18 in 2020. But we changed a lot to our program also in 2020, and massive changes in 2021. And I will get back to those results a bit later on. So why does ING do this actually? First of all, to differentiate from competition and to offer something extra as a plus to the service delivery of a bank. Second, to increase loyalty. People are quite loyal already to banks, but still we can prove that people that are used their loyalty points churn less than people that are not using or not having the points. And lastly, to boost engagement. We know that customers with a that are active in our program tend to talk more about ING and tend to talk more positively about ING. So this also comes in our NPS score. And secondly, it's time spent. When a few years ago, an active customer with ING logged on every 3 to 5 days into their electronic banking environment. But right now, people maybe log on 5 times a day on their mobile banking app. But these are quite short interactions. But if people click in their app towards the shop, they stay 5 to 7 times longer with ING. So we measure this actually also in time spent. So I will make a little bit of jump here to what we did to succeed even further, because actually this was already a success story with ING, but in 2018 we changed a few things because we had quite a big need for change. As I said, you should be where your customer is. Well, we weren't. The shift to mobile, as I explained, from people logging on to their electronic banking environment every 5 days, now logging on 5 times a day in their banking app. We were not there with the program. We also were not that flexible. It was known as Rentepunten, which was only for people with a savings account. And points were also only awarded for the acquired interest on that savings account. And Now, also in 2018, savings was not really a focus for our clients, and we as a bank wanted to trigger and to incentivize triggers and behavior that is in interest of the customer and ING. And for savings, we were kind of stuck there, so we needed to be more flexible there, and also relevancy. As I said, the focus of clients was no longer on savings, and also the assortment in the shop, we changed it to have to be more relevant for our customers. So first, being where the customer is, we actually added the ING points to the banking overview in the mobile banking app. As you can see on the left, you see this customer A. Van Dijk has lots of points on two accounts. If he clicks on that, he can see a little bit of explanation about the shop, and then jumps to the shop where he's already logged in and is ready to shop. This was introduced in February 2021, and actually we had an increase in almost 3 times in traffic. Currently we have 75,000 visits per day and about 7,000 products sold per day. Then be flexible. We changed actually the base to award point for. As I explained, you can get now points for lots of stuff, and we also kept that flexible to incentivize triggers that are important for ING, but also good for the customer, like getting more used to the digital processes at ING, incentivizing the usage of the mobile banking app, for example. And also our focus was on rewarding behavior instead of the possession of products. So if you use the mobile banking app, you will receive a point. And in the future, we will be focusing on real-time rewards. Now it will take up to a month before you receive your points. We still see the correlation between behavior and incentive, but we expect that when we have a real-time reward, so you did you qualified for a certain amount of points and you receive it directly, we will expect much more of that. We saw an increased awareness of ING points because of this new program. We also this was back in 2018. We also changed the name from Rentepunten to Punten, and also we saw increased behavior on the incentivized triggers. And then be relevant. We started by awarding for points for mobile transactions, as I said, but also cross-selling to banking propositions within our shop environment, which are the primary products of ING. But also we changed the assortment in the shop, and we introduced some retention proposition, as we call it. For example, a discount on cleaning your car, a discount on your antivirus scanners for your computers. Those kind of products, we try to get people get back to our shop to use the points, and to come back a few times a year with us. And in the future, we will start more on personalized offerings based on what you have bought in the ING shop, but also on the possessions you have currently with ING. So I want to share you a few results about these changes. First, as I told already, the traffic and sales. Traffic went up by 2.9 to 75,000 visitors per day. And also our sales increased. And we expect to report that we sold over 565,000 products in quarter one. This is actually more than we sold in quarter one and quarter two in 2020. So we were growing massively in the past quarter. Then loyalty, we know that users have a significant lower churn rate, and also users have more products and CING as the primary bank. And also people talk more positive about ING when they start using their loyalty point. And then, as I told, engagement time spent went up with 5 to 7 times compared with a normal visit. And our NPS is plus 18, which is around 15 to 20 points higher than a customer that doesn't use the loyalty point. I also wanted to stretch is that but as we grew in traffic by almost 3 times, our conversion rate remained quite good, actually. In 2020, our conversion rate was around 9 to 10%, and right now it's 8.4%, which is still quite high. And we think that this is because the traffic comes straight from our own app, which is an in high quality traffic in the first place. And secondly, our conversion rate is quite high because people feel the urge to spend points, even though the points do not have an expiration. Our customers still feel as they have the points, they would like to spend it in the shop, which is just an extra trigger to convert. So my key message for today: be where the customer is, be flexible, and be relevant. This was my talk, and I'm happy to answer questions if they are.
Yes, thanks. Thanks for your talk, Wouter. Let's wait a bit to see if any questions come in. Thanks again for your talk. I think it makes it super clear what ING does and why a loyalty program is impactful for your business. Thank all the attendees that were here on this beautiful afternoon. Thank you, Wouter, again. For participating, and I hope to see everyone in a next webinar.